This presentation is entitled Humanity's Changing Metaphors of Nature. And a reasonable question to ask, especially in a history conference, is why study metaphors? Well, that's the first thing we're going to look at. And then, after I've hopefully convinced you that it's worthwhile, we'll be looking at the changing metaphors humans have used to understand the natural world throughout history, and then take a look at some of the newly emerging metaphors of nature in our present time. So, most of us think of metaphors as some kind of poetic conceit, such as in this quote from Shakespeare's Hamlet, where the metaphor is the idea of the morning being a person walking in the distance. But a metaphor is, in fact, far more than a poetic conceit. It can also represent a transformation from an embodied experience to an abstract idea. And it's necessary for virtually any kind of conceptual thought. When we begin to look at the metaphors we use unconsciously, it can help us to see the underlying values we implicitly hold through that metaphor. The cognitive linguist George Lakoff, who wrote a groundbreaking book on this subject some years ago, explains that we can understand metaphors as describing one domain of experience in terms of another. So if you think of a person having embodied experiences of things like up, down, near, far, warm, cold, he's actually talking metaphorically when he says something like, I'm feeling up today, or she's grown distant from me, or she gave me a warm smile. In fact, what Lakoff points out is that metaphors are ubiquitous in common speech. Just take a look at these sentences. I gave you that idea. Or he broke under cross-examination. All sentences that we automatically understand without thinking of them as metaphoric. Now, consider the metaphors implicit in each of these sentences. When we begin to really examine our language, we discover that, in fact, metaphor is required for most kinds of conceptual thinking. As Lakoff says, it makes possible science, philosophy, and all other forms of abstract theoretical reasoning. And on closer examination, we begin to see that our most fundamental concepts, such as time, events, causation, the mind, the self, and morality, are multiply metaphorical. Metaphors matter because the core metaphors we use frame how we think about virtually everything. Our cognitive frames affect how we act individually, socially, ethically, and politically. Our choice of metaphor can fundamentally affect human behavior. And now, as we examine the changing metaphors of nature through history, we'll see how they indicate changing assumptions, attitudes, and behaviors towards the natural world. And by the way, for those of you who saw me present a couple of days ago, you'll be seeing some of the same phase transitions I discussed then, but this time through a different lens. As we go, I would invite you to ask yourselves the following question. How does our lived experience create our foundational metaphors? And how do our metaphors affect our priorities and actions? We'll begin our study with the hunter-gatherers who have comprised 95% of human history. Even today, most discussions of hunter-gatherer societies tend to get bogged down by the center-resolved debate between two sets of cliches. There's the Hobbesian view that life was nasty, brutish, and short. And on the other side is the Rousseau-inspired set of ideas about the noble savage. Well, there's a lot of truth to both sides, but perhaps Rousseau actually has the edge. When Captain James Cook first discovered Australia, He was amazed to observe the aboriginals there living in what he saw as tranquility, because the earth and sea furnishes them with all things necessary for life. And it turns out he was largely right. Modern anthropologists have found that hunter-gatherers do indeed place minimal value on possessions, enjoy plenty of leisure time, have access to a wide variety of food sources which provide them with good nutrition, and historically, at least, before the rise of agriculture, they were free of infectious disease. One anthropologist, Marshall Salins, famously called hunter-gatherers the original affluent society because they had everything they needed. In these words of an Aboriginal elder, everything come up out of ground. And with this relationship to the natural world, we find that across the globe, from the Ojibwa in Canada to the Nayaka in India, hunter-gatherers view the spirits of nature as their relatives, their grandmother, grandfather, or big mother and father, leading to the core hunter-gatherer metaphor of nature as giving parent. And in fact, over the millennia, as nature gave and gave, our hunter-gatherer ancestors took and took, leading to vast extinctions of large mammals across the world. As this chart shows, each time early humans migrated to a new landmass, the large mammals there, naive to humans, were driven very quickly to extinction by those pioneering hunter-gatherers who took full advantage of nature's generosity to them. But this all changed with the rise of agriculture about 10,000 years ago. It's with the domestication of animals and plants that we first see notions of property and land ownership arise, along with hierarchies and inequalities. Specialized skills emerge with massive organized projects such as irrigation and temples, leading to large, complex societies with citizen empires. Along with this came a profound change in the human condition, which you might call agricultural anxiety. For the first time, lives are dependent on the fluctuations of the weather. People are committed to the crops they've cultivated and the animals they've bred. They are locked into their location by their housing, storage, machinery, and possessions. The reduced variety of their food sources leads to vulnerability to crop failure. And the higher population density results in famine, epidemics, and warfare. Not surprising, then, that the agricultural view of the gods becomes more distant and threatening. Across the world, from Egypt to the Incas, from China to the Aztec, people saw themselves as active participants in a great cosmic drama, a little bit like Odysseus in that last presentation. Nature could no longer be counted upon for its generosity, and humans became supplicants to their gods, introducing an entirely new relationship between God and man. Along with this comes a rise in priesthood, sacrifice, and ritual, and a new metaphor of nature as divinity to propitiate. And there was an ever-increasing need to propitiate those divinities, since the growth of agriculture led to new forms of environmental degradation with erosion, decreased fertility, salinization, and deforestation. One historian, for example, has estimated that the crop yields in Sumer were reduced by 2/3 over a 700-year period with so much salinization that you'd regularly read in the ancient texts, the earth turned white. Then around 2,000 years ago, we see the beginnings of monotheism, with the ancient Greeks, who were the first to separate the human soul from the body, leading to an all-encompassing dualism, where the meaning of the universe came from a transcendent dimension, completely separate from the material world. This gave rise, before too long, to Christianity, the first systematic dualistic cosmology with a transcendent God who is the ultimate source of the laws of nature. And one of those laws was that man's role was to dominate nature, to have dominion over the fish of the sea, the fowl of the air, over the cattle, and over all the earth. This was an idea that took hold of the Christian world through the millennium. From Philo in the first century, who saw the human role to drive and steer the things on earth like a governor subordinate to the chief and great king, to Peter Lombard in the 12th century, who recognized that the world is made for the sake of man, that it may serve him, to Matthew Hale in the 17th century, who saw man as the viceroy of the great God of heaven and earth in this inferior world, generating a new metaphor of nature as subject of man's dominion. It's a metaphor that justified further exploitation of both nature and other humans. As John Locke put it in the 17th century, land that is left wholly to nature is waste. This ethic of human domination legitimized the conquest of those humans, such as the indigenous people of the Americas, who were in a supposedly animal condition and who were wasting the land that God had given them. Which leads us to the scientific age and a view of nature as a machine, causing Descartes to see no difference between machines made by craftsmen and those various bodies that nature alone composes, and the theologian William Paley to come up with the analogy of God as the great watchmaker. The clarion call of the scientific age, in the words of that great scientific visionary, Francis Bacon, was to extend the bounds of human empire and render ourselves the masters and possessors of nature. Throughout the modern age, the one thing both right and left agreed upon was the goal of exploiting nature. Here's Peter Drucker, a business consultant, noting that human possession and use is what activates the true nobility of any natural object. And here's Karl Marx from a century earlier, writing that the goal of socialism is bringing nature under the common control, resulting in the current predominant metaphor of nature as resource to be exploited, which is something we've done only too well, as shown by the exponential rise in human population in the last few centuries, which has unfortunately brought with it an exponential rise in other things, such as the unsustainable level of carbon dioxide we're putting into the atmosphere. Which leads us to the final section in the presentation on the newly emerging metaphors of nature being offered by those who are trying to respond to our current global environmental crisis. One metaphor, popularized by scientist René Dubos, based on the philosophy of the Benedictine order, is nature as property for stewardship, with a message that we should continue to change the world to suit our needs, but do it in a spirit of noblesse oblige. What are the underlying implications or entailments of this metaphor? That we have ultimate control over nature, that our motives are beneficial for nature, and that we have the right to prioritize what benefits humanity. The darker implications arising from this can be seen in this quote from political commentator Charles Krauthammer, stating that nature will just have to accommodate because ultimately it is man's environment. Another metaphor sees nature as a source of what are called ecosystems services, an approach championed nowadays by many environmentalists. The idea is to put a monetary value on the services that healthy ecosystems provide for human populations and thus align market forces with conservation. This, however, also brings with it some disturbing entailments, with the risk of inappropriate trade-offs, moral justification for continuing exploitation, and the ultimate value of nature being a resource for the global marketplace. So, for example, one study put the value of coral reefs at $1.2 million per hectare. At the same time, however, prime beachfront property in Cancun is valued at $25 million per hectare. If we have to decide on a trade-off between the two, then the ecosystem services metaphor would justify choosing a new high-rise hotel on the beach, even at the loss of the coral reefs. This entailment becomes even more disturbing when we look at the melting Arctic polar ice cap, which has lost 40% in the past three decades. From an economic point of view, this opens up commercial sea lanes and makes available $9 trillion worth of oil that was previously impossible to access. So from an ecosystem services perspective, the melting ice cap is great news for all concerned. A third metaphor sees nature as a geoengineering subject, advocating deliberate large-scale intervention in the Earth's natural systems to counteract climate change, thus protecting critically vulnerable natural ecosystems from damage that otherwise could no longer be avoided. This metaphor also carries with it some disturbing entailments, such as the risk of unforeseen consequences, political issues, and some fundamental moral issues, including the fact that it permits continued growth without fixing the underlying dynamics of our society's problems. Which is why it's not surprising that this metaphor has been warmly adopted by the oil industry, as in this recent statement from the Exxon CEO, that global warming is an engineering problem that has engineering solutions. But a branch of modern science known as systems thinking offers us an alternative metaphor of nature. Findings in systems biology and complexity science teach us that all living entities are complex, self-organized, dynamical systems, that interactions between things are more important than the things themselves, and that no system is autonomous, but continually interacting with other systems. This understanding suggests a new metaphor of nature as a fractally connected organism. A fractal is a pattern that repeats itself at different scales. It indicates self-organized activity and is ubiquitous in the natural world, in coastlines, in leaves, in lightning, in lungs, and in neurons. Everywhere in the natural world, from the tiniest cell to the shape of continents, from deep within our bodies to the vastness of the sky above, fractal patterns remind us of our ultimate connectivity to everything around us. Seeing nature as a fractally connected organism means recognizing that every cell exists as part of an organism, which is part of a community, which is part of a greater ecosystem, which is ultimately part of the Earth. The benefits of this metaphor is that it represents a scientifically valid view of the natural world and sees humans as embedded in nature, not transcendent over it. It emphasizes humanity's dependence on the health of the Earth and encourages sustainable values and priorities. As George Lakoff wrote, metaphors matter. They can determine questions of war and peace, economic policy, and legal decisions. I hope this presentation has shown that the metaphors we use determine a great deal about how we live our lives. And for anyone interested, I'm writing a book incorporating some of these ideas, offering a cognitive history of humanity, documenting our changing modes of thought over the millennia, and how the choices we make about our thought patterns will affect the future course of humanity. It's called Biology Towards an Integration of Science and Meaning, and you can check my progress on this website. Great, thank you.